Cricket is a team sport for two teams of 11 players. A formal game can last anything from an afternoon to several days. It's not a sport that we in America understand very well, but cricket has come to the Bay Area and our education begins. Stay tuned.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years of our lives. The name of our program is inspired by a quotation from Robert Browning. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be, the last of life for which the first was made. Now, sit back and enjoy a program made especially to provide seniors with useful information, plus some lighter moments to brighten your day.
Hello, I'm Val Jeffrey of The Better Part. Whilst in England recently, I had a wonderful day out at a charity cricket match in Hampshire, and you'll see some of the footage during the program. Cricket has always been a very popular sport in England. It's played around the world, but not very much here in America. Here in the studio today, my guests are Hermuth and Kinjal Bush, who founded the California Cricket Academy in the summer of 2003. The Academy has already brought regular cricket instruction to many young men and women aged 6 to 15. Welcome, Hermuth.
Thank you, Val. Thanks for inviting today.
And welcome, Kinjal.
Hi, Val. We are happy to be here today.
So, cricket in Cupertino, how did that come about?
Cupertino has a very large ethnic population from Indian subcontinent and other cricket-loving countries around the world. Almost 1 in 10 person is familiar with the game, has played cricket before, has watched it. And I think because of this, the city of Cupertino, the school districts are more familiar with the game. They see game being played all around the town, either in the parks or in a more official format or unofficial format. So even the people who really don't play cricket, they know about the game. It is not just a word out of a dictionary for them. They know what cricket is. And that's why I think Cupertino is the best place to start the cricket at grassroots level, where we have a lot of kids who are actually interested in the game, but did not have opportunity to play till now.
So how were you introduced to the game in the first place?
You know, cricket runs in our blood. So from the very childhood, that's a sport that's so popular and so easily available and so much played so much around us all the time that, you know, it's impossible to stay away from it. And it's a very entertaining game. So I've always enjoyed it.
Typically in England, there's a pavilion looking out over the whole cricket ground, called the cricket pitch. The pitch is marked with a boundary line. The area in the center is called the wicket, where batsmen score runs, and there's always somewhere to have tea. America is not quite there yet, but the Academy is making great strides. So who's going to tell me about the Academy?
Kinjal is a big part of the Academy and starting the Academy, so I would...
Back in 2003, that summer we spent here. And the year before that, our kids visited India and they saw cricket all around them, in TV, on streets, in the newspapers, everywhere. And I think that's when we figured out that they are really keen to learn the game. So in 2003, we started with a group of 22 kids because you need 11 in each team. And we thought the best way to make them enjoy the game is to really teach them, because it tends to be, it is a very technical game. And if they learn it properly, they do enjoy it. And that's why we thought we'll establish the academy, we'll provide proper coaching to them, we'll provide them infrastructure so they have all the opportunities to really learn the game and enjoy it. That's how it started. From 22 in 2003, we have grown to be about 150 kids this year, probably more. And we see a lot of new people coming and staying with us since the time they join us. And now we have about 5 to 6 teams in different age groups, and they play amongst each other. One thing is, it's a very good team sport. It teaches a lot of discipline, a lot of team spirit, a lot of respect for the other. It is technical, so you have to be very focused in the game. So all these aspects we thought can help them as they grow, even outside of the cricket. So that's how the academy came about.
There's two teams, 11 players in each, and one team is fielding.
Right.
And then there are two people batting.
Yes.
So let's take it from there.
The aim is that the batter wants to score as many runs as they can, and the bowler wants to prevent them from scoring runs and get them out. So that is how the battle begins.
How do they score runs?
So every time they run between the wickets, that's one run. And however many times that it gets added up. They can also, as you earlier described, the wicket, the pitch with the boundary lines. So if the ball rolls down where there's no fielder and it crosses the boundary line, they get 4 runs. If they hit a home run, or if they hit high and it crosses the boundary.
Without bouncing. It is 6 runs.
It is six runs. Yes.
Okay.
So the goal is to score as much as they can. So cricket games are typically high-scoring games.
Right.
Yes.
So who decides who's going to run? When the batsman hits it, how do they know when they're going to run and exchange ends?
This is when it's a totally judgment call, and the batter, depending on who is closer to the stump on the other end, or the end where there is a risk, decides whether he wants to run or not. And so that is called a call. They have to call each other and say, yes, let's go for it, I'm okay, or no. But this has to happen in split second.
Right. And I also do know, if they start running and they change their mind, they can run back to their own ends.
Yes.
As long as they get there before the ball gets, the bails get knocked off by the ball, right?
Yes.
That's right.
They have to be in the popping crease before the bail gets knocked off by the throw.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Well, this all takes a lot of coaching. Tell me a little bit about your coaches.
We have a few local coaches. We have been successful in getting some international coaching also for our kids. And as you can see, it is a very technical game. So anybody playing the cricket cannot necessarily coach. And especially when it comes to coaching small kids, the kids in the age group 6 to 15 years, you have to be, it is a whole different ball game.
Hi, I'm Naresh, and I'm the parent volunteer coach for the Centurions team that's playing right now on the field. And I've been coaching for as a volunteer at CCA for the past 2 years, slightly over 2 years. And my challenge here for the team is to make sure that they are focused on the game and that they're able to focus more on the technique and competence building rather than on hitting the ball real high and far. I think the objective is to learn the game ground up and not so much be a star in the first game itself.
Hi, my name is Prem. I've been a parent volunteer coach with CCA for the last 2.5 years. And I find a lot of enthusiasm amongst the kids. The toughest part here, from what I've noticed, is trying to get this kid to play cricket other than baseball here in the US. And that's the toughest part what we find, because some of them do play baseball and the techniques are slightly different. So we need to make sure that they get this right.
So what experience do you have? Have you played cricket for many years?
Yeah, I have played cricket during my youth. I used to play for a state in India. I then subsequently moved to Singapore. I played for many years in Singapore and then also for a few years in the US as well. So I have a reasonable amount of experience playing some serious cricket, but it's been a long while since I played as competitive cricket as I see now among the kids.
So you can see the kids get better and better each coaching session?
Oh, it's been fantastic. In the last year, the kids were probably one-tenth as good as they are today. And they're just between 10 to 13 years old. But their maturity that I see in the last 1 year has been tremendous. It's been very fulfilling for us.
And I hear you've just had a win down in L.A. under-15s, is that correct?
Yeah, it was a marvelous game. I could not go there. My colleague Prem went over there and they did a fantastic job. The last year when we went there, we did not do as well. But this year, it was a grand slam for us. We won every game that we played.
Well, congratulations. I'm glad to see cricket here in America. Hi, I'm Val. Can you introduce yourself?
Yeah, hi, I'm Arsh Butch.
And how long have you been playing cricket?
2 or 3 years.
Are you a left-hander or a right-hander?
Well, I bowl left-handed and I bat right-handed.
You do? Do you write with your right or your left hand?
Left hand.
So you're a lefty like me. Can I have another look at your bat?
Sure.
Do you know what the bat's made of?
Well, there are different kinds of willows. This is the English willow. It's different kind of wood. There are other bats which have Kashmir willow and things like that. So, yeah.
Are bats always the same size, or you have to get a bigger one as you grow?
Yeah, it depends on how you depends. But yeah, I tend to get a bigger one when I grow.
And how many runs have you scored this season?
I don't know.
You don't know? That's okay. Thanks for talking to me.
Yeah.
Well, in a game of cricket, there are two umpires, and I will get them to explain what their job is. What do you actually do?
The first and foremost job that we have as umpire is the cricket game should be played under the rules. It's a very disciplined game and there are lots of rules that have been published. So first and foremost, whether the game is played within the rules or not. Secondly, we decide in terms of if the batsman, he is out or not. Thirdly, we decide when the bowler is bowling a ball. There are a lot of rules like no balls, wides. Buys, the way runs are scored. So we signal that and we are always in tune with scorers. So you talk to scorers as well. So they keep on waving at us in terms of they got it and that's how the entire game is played.
Where do you actually stand to do your umpiring?
There are two positions for umpiring. There is one position called as main umpire who stands behind the wickets on the side of the bowler, and there is another wicketkeeper who stands on the left side of the batsman.
Okay, well there are two official scorers.
Hamsa Suri.
Bhavan Elakanti.
And I want to find out how the scores get tallied. Can you help me with that?
Sure. Today we had one innings each. Each team plays one innings. So what we are seeing here is the second innings here on the top. The first innings, they scored 85 in 25 overs. And the second innings, the team was chasing the 85 runs in 25 overs and they scored 40 runs for 9 wickets in 25 overs. That's what this board tells us here.
Okay, well thank you very much. I don't think I understood a word you said.
Okay.
So what's an innings?
So one innings is where you get 25 overs to play and there are 10 wickets for the team. So if the 10 wickets fall, then it's the end of the innings even though you haven't played the 25 overs. So that's one innings, right, of one team.
Okay, so the overs are the bowler bowling.
An over is 6 balls, basically, for a particular bowler. So once the bowler is done with 6 balls, another bowler takes over, and he bowls 6 balls for an over. Every bowler gets 5 overs of maximum, 5 overs that they can bowl in a particular innings. So so that's it. That's how the overs go. So there are 25 overs. So when the team gets all the 10 wickets, then the innings is completed. You don't
okay,
have necessarily...
Okay, so what you're saying is that when the 10 batsmen get out...
Yes. When the 10 batsmen get out, then the innings is completed, even though you haven't completed the 25 overs.
Well, we hope that we've simplified that for you. Talk to you later.
My father was the captain of the Morden Wanderers cricket
club in
England many years ago, and he used to take me with him. He was a spin bowler.
Okay.
And I brought his ball here today just for good luck for me and to remember him.
Good.
There's spin bowling. Could you explain the other kind of bowling and when you would use that particular technique?
Yes. So when each team has four or five bowlers, they typically have fast bowlers who are like, who bowl at anywhere from 85 to 95 miles per hour speed.
Wow.
Then there are spin, because in cricket, the ball actually drops on the pitch, on the wicket, and then, you know, it is anybody's guess.
It comes to the batter. So
the spinner can...
So it's harder to hit.
Yeah.
It's harder to hit because you don't know what the ball is going to do after it bounces.
No, it can go any direction.
Exactly.
Right.
And that's where spinners can make your life really miserable because you don't know it's coming in, going out, how fast it's going straight. So you really have to watch them and you really have to study their bowling and see how and where it's going to go.
So in a typical game, the fast bowlers tend to bowl first because at that time the ball is very shiny.
Uh-huh.
It comes on very fast and you can get the batsman out. When the ball becomes a little older, then the spinners come into picture and they bowl spin bowling.
Oh,
because then that's when, you know, the ball has pretty much lost its shine and the... Because it bounces, they are able to do wonders with the spinning and get the batsman out.
Well, now I know why my father's ball is not shiny and new.
Right. So if you look at it, you have a shiny ball and a
shiny ball and a
matte spinner's ball. Ball.
Yeah. What's the ball made of, by the way?
It's a cork.
It is hard cork
and natural material.
Yeah.
That it is made.
And then the leather covering.
Outside.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there's threaded seam. Mm. And that seam plays a very important role in in swinging the balls because when you pitch and when you bowl, if it falls on that seam, then it gives that little extra direction to it because it's a little more prominent on the ball. So that's how.
Well, you mentioned the speed of the ball and how fast it goes. How fast do the kids bowl in comparison?
Kids probably bowl 60 to 75
miles an hour.
And the professionals?
About 80 to 100 miles an hour. The fastest recorded till this day is about 100 miles an hour.
Wow, that's really fast. How does the condition of the pitch affect the bowling, the way that the ball hits?
The condition of the pitch is very important. And that depending on that condition is how a captain decides whether he wants to bowl or bat today first. The pitch has to be consistent, so the bowler can predict the effect of his technique. That when he bowls, he has to have a confidence that, you know, if he wants to bounce the ball or if he wants to swing the ball or if he wants to spin in certain direction, it will go in that direction. So that consistency and maintenance and of the pitch is very important. And so, you know, sometimes it's moisture in the air that also helps naturally because, you know, it helps in swinging the ball. And if the pitch is a little hard, then it'll bounce a little more. If it's a little damp or soft, then it'll be good for probably spinners.
Mm-hmm.
It'll come quick, but it'll not bounce as much.
As mentioned at the beginning of the program, I visited a charity cricket match in England. I had a wonderful time. I met some interesting people. Devon Malcolm, an ex-England test match player. Nadeem Shahid, who played for Essex and Surrey, and now coaches at Surrey. And Andrew Elliott, previously a BBC radio reporter.
Hi, I'm Val Jeffrey and I'm visiting England, and I thought while I was here I'd catch a local cricket match. I was very lucky to find that playing for one team was not only a BBC commentator but a person who played for the County of Surrey. So I'm going to hand over to Andrew Elliott, who is going to be doing the interview for me. Over to you, Andrew.
Hello, I'm Andrew Elliott and I'm captaining the defending champions here today at South Tidworth. I've got along here with me today my professional who's helping out and giving his time up for charity today. That's Nadeem Shahid. Afternoon to you, Nadeem.
Hello, Andrew. How are you going?
Yes, not too bad at all, actually. As far as the match situation is going, we're not doing too well, as the scoreboard is unfortunately telling us. We're currently 56 for 5 with a target of 129. So we're probably second favourites at the moment. We've already lost Nadeem, but I just wanted to talk a little bit to you about this type of match. You had quite a long career with both Essex and Surrey. How difficult is it for you to get yourself up for a match like this for charity?
Well, it's not a matter of getting yourself off for matches like this. It's a game of cricket, and you know it's for great cause. And we all love cricket. I've played it for 20 years or so, and I know you've had a long career as well. It's just the fact that a lot of people give up their time, and you do the same thing. And it's enjoyable, isn't it? It's enjoyable, and you know it's for a good cause. And plus, it gets you out of the office, doesn't it?
It does indeed. You've got a new office at the Oval, I believe, with Surrey. But just going back to what you've just said there, so the reason why you took up cricket in the first place and got good at it has carried on through your professional career, and now that's come to an end. You still love the game enough to come and turn out a match like this.
I mean, cricket gave me a really good lifestyle, made a lot of good friends with it, toured the world with it. It's given me a lot, and the least I can do is give up my time for very worthwhile charities that I believe in, and this being one of them.
Okay, how long do you envisage yourself playing cricket in one way or another and contributing to days like this and the many others that come along?
As long as I possibly can. If I can, I will. I mean, I'll try and keep myself fit, so maybe till I'm 50, 60, who knows?
Okay, well, I know that this is the second year that you've played for me in a row. Didn't go quite as well today as it did in the first year, but hopefully you'll be along next year. We're very grateful for your support.
Enjoyed it, but if it was that easy, I scored runs every time, it would be a pretty boring game, wouldn't it? And it is a great leveller. One day you're up there, next day you're down there, it's how you deal with it, isn't it?
And I guess if you'd scored 162 every day of your life, you'd still be playing.
Probably not, actually. maybe. It's not the fact that scoring runs, I stopped scoring runs. It's the fact that you lose the hunger of training hard and going to gym every day. And cricket's come a long way from 20, 30 years ago. That the fact that fitness plays a massive part. If you haven't got the willpower to get up every morning, go to gym and basically work your bum off, you feel you let your side down, you let the other guys down. And it's a young player's game, and the wheel has to turn, and this comes a right time where young players coming through, and it's their time. So I think everyone realises when your time is. It wasn't that I stopped scoring runs. I think it's the fact that I lost the hunger to actually train hard, more importantly.
Okay, well, hopefully you'll have the hunger to score a few runs for my side in this fixture for a few years to come. And maybe next year, if you can bring one of those up-and-coming players with you as well, we can see two professional players at the end of each at the opposite ends of their career. Thanks very much for your time, Nadeem.
You're welcome. Cheers.
Back to you, Valerie.
Andrew's team did in fact lose, but only just.
Oh, look at that.
Look at that.
And you did really, really well. How do you feel?
Well, Helena's a team player, and especially as captain, you come to a match to win. And I came here today to defend the Elaborate Cup. We looked in a good position when we restricted the opposition to 128. Then 50-something for 5, we looked like we were well out of the match. So I suppose from that position, John Kirkby batted beautifully to get a 50. But when he left the crease, called it cover, we again felt that we were probably out of the match. So to get up to lose by one run is a magnificent effort, but to get that close and to concede the cut by one run is disappointing, but it doesn't detract from the fact that this is a charity match, and hopefully we'll go on to raise a lot of money this evening, and by the end of the evening, when we count out how much money we've earned, then it might not it might mean that the losing doesn't feel quite so bad, especially when it's such a close match.
Getting young people involved, trained and dedicated to the sport is what the Academy is doing here in California. Let's hope that our program generates some interest in the sport and America will get a shot at the Cricket World Cup in the not too distant future.
We certainly hope for that, and we really thank you for helping us spread cricket in the community.
We are doing a wonderful job.
Yes, thank you, Val, for having us over here, and I'm sure if we can get more youngsters involved in the game, U.S. will have a team ready in near future.
Well, we will look forward to that, and we'll cover that. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Special thanks to Andrew Elliott and Nadeem Shahid for being such good sports at the charity match in England. And thanks to all the California Cricket Academy players, mums and dads and friends who made us so very welcome. For information on the CCA, look up their website, www.calcricket.org. And that's all for now. You can reach our team through the Cupertino Senior Centre, 408-777-3150, or visit our website, www.thebetterpart.com. And one thing that we won't hear in California much is rain stop play. Join us again, and thank you for watching.